Education, Software Technology Parks of India, Institutions Innovation Council, Innovation Hub, Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India, GTU Innovation Council, and MNIT Innovation and Incubation Center. Think India is honored to have such wonderful change makers from the artificial intelligence.
हेलो
हेलो शिवानी जी, यू आर आपके नेटवर्क में कुछ शायद इश्यू आ गया है। सॉरी शिवानी जी फॉर स्टॉपिंग यू इन बिटवीन, बट आप है ना, आपका शायद कुछ नेटवर्क इश्यू है, तो आप अपना वीडियो, हाँ अब सही, आप अपना वीडियो ऑफ करके स्टार्टिंग से फिर से इंट्रोडक्शन से स्टार्ट कर सकते हैं हम लोग।
Harsh, is anybody speaking?
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, hi, is anybody?
I'm sorry, everyone. Yeah. Hello, sir. I'm sorry. There is some kind of connection loss from our moderator. We are checking it. Please wait for some time. Hello everyone. I'm Kaustub. I welcome you all to Think India Indigenous Startup and Innovation Week. I'm sorry for the difficulty in the connection loss from our moderator. I'll start the session now. So first of all, I would like to welcome our first speaker, Mr. Akash Surekha ji. He is the CEO of Taviska, a CX loyalty company. He is a serial entrepreneur with successful exit to many public companies. He comes with a strong background with more than 20 plus years of varied technology product and business leadership experience in global technology companies like Nvidia, Wellcare, Persistent Systems, etc. Prior joining to Taviska, Akash ji was a founder and CEO of a global product startup company in the mobile internet ecosystem, acquired by Persistent Systems. He was also a CEO of SAS company, later acquired by Software AG. I would like to welcome Mr. Akash Sureka ji on our platform and guide us all in the field of AI startups. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope everyone can hear me. I know I only have, I think, 15-20 minutes to talk. So I was wondering what should I really talk in that short amount of time. But first of all, thank you, Think India, and the whole team around Think India for inviting me to talk on this forum. And really kind of excited to talk. A quick background, you know, as you know, the host just mentioned, you know, I founded an AI company in very early years, which was around 2009-2010. And I remember when I was talking about it, a lot of people were calling me crazy. I was in UK, I was in New York, and I was showing what AI can done in, you know, do in the future. And our company was all around AI on smartphones. And, you know, incidentally, and kind of in the excitement, I was sitting on my sofa chair, I still remember. And, you know, I was reading, you know, something on my phone. And when I was reading on my phone, you know, an article or so, I wanted to kind of look out for more information around that article. And every time I have to do that, I have to kind of go on different applications or internet to search and find out and so on, right? And that was actually disturbing me because I have to break my rhythm while reading that article, then myself have to go out and look out for a lot of information and so on. So I said, you know, why can't a software do that for me, or why can't a technology do all that for me while I'm concentrating on my article? Because I have established my context, I have established what I'm reading, I've established what I'm looking for. What else a technology would want, you know, otherwise to help me assist in finding what I'm looking at. And that's how then I started my company. This was obviously 10-12 years after I had been, you know, creating global products in Motorola, Nokia, and NVIDIA. And then I kind of thought maybe we could create a software and technology on phones, on smart TVs, on car dashboards, anywhere, right, where you have, you know, computerization on a smaller, medium, or a bigger basis. And we can create certain software and technology which could assist in discovering all sort of information based on the context. That's why eventually I founded out my own company. We had a lot of IPs and patents around it. And, you know, an idea which was just going on in my mind because it was a real problem that part of time, what I was facing through. And then with certain more, you know, research, with some more users, with more potential customers and so on, we figured out maybe that's the right problem to solve, and we started this company, and we created AI software for phones, wherein in these phones it was essentially working as an assistant. And by the way, this was in 2011, even before Google started its whole Google Now and Google Allo and so on, right? We were very early, we created those softwares, we had our own patents, and we kind of created that technology, which was essentially later on started getting called as AI, which was also called as an AI before, but that was not so streamlined. And at that particular point of time, obviously AI was very premature. There were no concrete and matured open source softwares the way it exists today. The hardwares were still evolving. The softwares were all evolving. Everything was evolving that point of time. Then we created our own proprietary softwares around that on learning the context, on creating the recommendation engines, on creating the prediction engines, on utilizing whatever speech to text, text to speech exists that point of time, and work on top of it and so on. And eventually we created an AI software which was running on the phone, which was acting as an assistant. We had a lot of partnerships across travel, commerce, contents, deals, books and lot many things, search, which was actually assisting then users based on their context whenever required to discover and recommend few things. I mean, imagine, you know, you were actually looking out to go for a pizza, but then you wanted to find out which one was the best nearest pizza center. You wanted to find out what's the latest deal going on, and you wanted to find out what's the latest review of that restaurant nearby for pizza, right? And imagine assistant doing all of that for you, just that once you share that context with that assistant, right? And we were able to do that. We also then thought to extend this to a lot of other devices. We said, you know what, if you are on your smart TV and if you are watching, you know, a movie on certain actor, and you know, or a web series on, you know, on certain theme or certain, you know, group of actors and so on, can we use that context? And then if user wants, we can do a lot more things. So for example, if you are watching a song of, you know, let's say with Narayan on YouTube on your smart TV, and then you're sitting on your car after that, maybe going on to kind of get some bites for you, and based on your mood, on your theme, on your context, it can actually suggest you what should be the nicest restaurant you should go to match your theme, you know, what's the deal going on there. And then also look out if there is any other musical concert going on, and then the car can actually assist you, because now you're sitting in the car and the car can assist you on that theme, where you should drive, you know, is there any concert going on, and so on, right? So all that context coming together, you know, all that learnings coming together, and all our AI software across all of these devices, you know, working and kind of helping discover many more things based on those contexts. So that's why eventually we kind of created those softwares. We had a lot of patterns. It was an exciting journey. And then eventually, obviously, we were acquired by Persistent Systems. We created a lot of platform around that. We were also nominated as top technology pioneers by World Economic Forum for what we have done, and so on, right? So it was a wonderful journey around artificial intelligence in very early days. And obviously, if you see 2013-14 onwards, there were a lot of innovations and a lot of headway which was done around artificial intelligence, and you keep on seeing that today. Essentially, you know, artificial intelligence has expanded in various categories, right? So one is obviously, there is this whole data category. The second one is this whole machine learning category, which sits on all top of data. And then you have this whole NLP category, which sits on, you know, all of the languages. And all those three combined, you know, then form up the overall artificial intelligence as the overall technology. Data becomes a key for all of these artificial, because if you correlate with what we have done in the past as well, it was all about data, it was all about context, and so on. The more and more data you have, the better and better models you can build, the better and better predictions you can build, the better and better recommendations you can build, and the better and better accuracies can come in. And then that's where the machine learning part comes in, wherein you can have various types of networks, whether it could be a recurring, you know, neural network, it could be a convolutional neural networks, and so on, right? Different networking models, similar to the way our brain, by the way, acts and reacts and learns all of what we've been interacting with objects and so on in the life, right? And that's how our brain starts reacting as well and learning as well, you know, and eventually kind of gets us into an action. Similarly, exactly the same way the machine learning model works. And then you have one category of that, which is NLP, which is natural language processing, which, you know, works actually on the language. And the whole point of us being human beings, being so intelligent, is all because of language, right? So we can understand what people can say, we can speak, and then people can interact, and that's how our brain functions. And language becomes a very important part of our life. You know, imagine if we don't have a language, then maybe we are as good as any other animal on the planet, right? And hence, NLP forms one of the very critical and key component of the whole artificial intelligence model, wherein, you know, you can have intelligent artificial conversations, you know, wherein where the chatbots, text to speech and speech to text, and a lot of algorithms on top of it, you know, using recurring neural networks and so on, comes across. So a lot of innovations have happened in all those categories. Different technologies which has come up, companies like Google, companies like Microsoft, companies like Amazon, companies like Nvidia, companies like Intel, and many other, you know, Tesla have taken a leap on AI, have created different products, whether it's in hardware, whether it's in software, whether it's in systems, whether it's in solutions. And that field has evolved and continue to evolve. And obviously, there's great future in artificial intelligence. As we all know, there are a lot of problems yet to be solved. There is massive amount of data crunching which is happening across the globe, whether it's about banking, whether it's about healthcare, whether it's about telecom, you know, whether it's about oil and gas, you know, and so on, right? Insurance industry, everywhere there is so much of data coming in. Everywhere there is expectation about a smart engine. There is expectation of good user experiences and customer experiences. And all of that is possible now because of this AI and technologies around that. There are technologies which are now readily available, wherein you may not have to work on actual algorithms. In our world in 2010, because the AI was not available as a service generally, we had to write our own algos, proprietary algos, our own APIs, and we have to build on top of it. However, in today's world, you have all that ready-made. So what means is that you don't have to think about technology, but you can think about what problems you can solve. You know, technology is just a commodity now around AI or machine learning or NLPs, right? And it's all about only how far you can stretch your brains on what problems you can solve in this world across all the industries, including agriculture as well. And in countries like India and similar emerging countries, you know, there are so many problems which we can solve using AI, whether it's a jobs market, whether it's about agri market, whether it's about insurance market, whether it's about retail market, e-commerce market. And I think AI is playing an important role everywhere now, as we all know. The future of AI obviously will be limited to hardware resources. How much and hardware can really accommodate any specific compute power to run and act on so much of data and come out with any kind of predictions and recommendations and scorings and so on, right? Which is where I think the future of AI will be driven by quantum computing. You know, I wouldn't go in details about quantum computing. That's my next sort of a charter to see what we can do in the area of quantum computing in the future after AI. Considering AI is getting commoditized from a technology standpoint, and there's a lot of innovation happening in quantum computers. And quantum computers will make that compute power available for massive amount of artificial intelligence and machine learning to be successful. So I'm really looking forward, you know, towards that direction in the future, in the next 4 years, 5 years, 10 years. And that's a great field for everybody of you to even explore if required, moving forward and create, you know, and solve massive problems which maybe today cannot be solved because of various limitations of resources and so on. So AI and quantum computing combined together provides a massive opportunity for all of us to solve large problems globally. And that also eventually opens up a lot of entrepreneurial opportunities for a lot of people to create bigger businesses around that. So maybe I'll take a pause over there. You know, I wanted to keep it short, but also before we wrap up on my talk, I think one of this most talked about topic is about what about jobs, right? How much of that jobs thing will be taken away from AI? Now, the hard fact is, yes, a lot of jobs will be taken away, you know, from, you know, or because of AI. But at the same point of time, a lot of new jobs can also be created, right? So I think there is an onus of a lot of younger people to start seeing those problems about what jobs can go away, but at the same point of time, using this new AI technology, using new quantum computing technologies, can you create more jobs so that people can be skilled on those technologies as well and start taking up those jobs as well as the previous jobs starts becoming redundant. Some of the most prominent jobs which are mechanical in nature, imagine you wouldn't need a man or a human being's life getting wasted in cleaning up, you know, pipes as an example, right? It's a waste of human life as an example, if you really think about it. The same human being can be utilized for, you know, much better work, you know, in the future. So I think I would say even if some of those jobs are getting translated, I think sometimes it may be even good for humankind, wherein some of the technologies can help them do something better. Some jobs like, you know, people wanting to, you know, fly drones, you know, those jobs will emerge out. some jobs like maybe teaching, maybe nursing, doctors and educations and so on, they will remain intact because there needs to be somebody who do that, and AI may not be able to take all of those jobs eventually. So there will be impact on some jobs, there won't be impact on some jobs, but I think onus is on all of us to create technologies and opportunities, and then use that as a platform to create more and more jobs for people, provided that people are getting upskilled in those some of the technologies as well. So that's where I would want to take a pause now. Happy to answer any questions you would have. I don't know if Q&A is allowed, but I want to kind of keep it very short and sweet. I think the future is quantum computing combined with AI. There are a lot of opportunities for everybody to create new solutions and new products and new technologies as long as you're solving the right problems. So I wish you all the best in that future, which is very exciting, by the way. I would suggest you kind of subscribe to a lot of artificial intelligence topics, because if you're ignoring that, then it's quite late. You start subscribing to even quantum computing, and you also start subscribing to some of the newer innovations in AI, which is happening, wherein people are trying to learn about human brains and how can you utilize those data and signals coming out of human brains to solve certain neuro diseases, as an example, to learn and predict few things which can be helpful to make life better and so on. Neuralink is a very good example, which is again founded by Elon Musk, by the way, and some of the great innovations happening. Obviously, there are pros and cons to different technologies, and as I always say, it's in our hands what is good and what is bad. As long as we're thinking good, I think the outcomes will be good. As long as we're thinking bad, the outcomes may be bad. So I think, again, the onus, along with solving great problems, along with creating great technologies, along with creating solutions on top of AI and quantum computing, the onus is also about us being responsible to create, which is eventually create something which is eventually in the benefit of the humankind using artificial intelligence and quantum computing. So thank you once again, but happy to take any questions if there is time. I don't know, I'll kind of pass on to the host. And if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Yes, sir. There is a question by Manoj Dasji. So he want to ask that with government and advocacy groups coming down heavily or like on companies misusing personal data. So do you see popping up companies dealing with data and like artificial intelligence?
So question is whether, you know, is government taking right steps around data privacy and so on? I think the answer is yes, right? So if you see, Europe has come out with their GDPR policy, not around data privacy. California and US has come out with California Privacy Act. I'm sure a lot of other states will also adopt. India is working on the data regulations and privacy rules, right? So a lot of countries will have the right rules, and I think this is the right time to have those rules and policies so that the end user's data is protected. If the end user's data is protected, I'm sure the outcomes will be much better, right? Because then there's a protection in place. There is a law around that in place. There is a governance around that data policy. And hence, any technology which will be applied on that data will eventually have a better outcome, right? So I think it's all in going in the right direction. And I hope, as I said, end of the day, it depends upon humankind. I think if humankind thinks about it in the right direction, I'm sure the outcomes will also be in the right direction.
Yes, sir. So, sir, there isn't one question more. So we are taking this question only. So the technology is growing day by day, and the technology is taking away jobs, and the robotics taking place in human. So there will be no jobs to humans. So what to do then? So there's a question by Gyan Prakash.
Yes, I wish I was able to share my screen, right? So there is this whole, sort of a concept around jobs lost, wherein, somebody was talking in a factory, or the future of factory will only have 2 employees, right? And those 2 employees will be one as a human being and one as an animal, which is most probably a dog, right? So what would eventually, even that one single human in that factory will do it? This is the future of the factory. So that human will actually feed the dog. That's his job, or that's her job, you know, in that factory. And dog is there to keep a watch on the human, to make sure that the human does not touch any equipment, right? So that's how far people have gone through to predict the nature of jobs, you know, in the future. And I think this could be, you know, mind-boggling, right? An example. There will be impact, as I said, on jobs. Some jobs wherein I say, you know, when I'm saying that, I think that work can be done by humans in a much, you know, in a different category, for example, because I think humankind has been created to create or do good things in life, right? But yes, I mean, realistically on the ground, there will be some impact on jobs. It all depends upon how humankind is adopting and getting upskilled on various newer technologies and newer skills required at the same point of time, right? That's how the problem will be solved. I think people who will be lazy to not look at that and not upskill them and not keep on adopting them every single day, they are the people who will obviously face some of the problems. But as I said, there are different other categories of jobs which are completely safe, and I think those will keep on intact, and a lot of requirements will start coming in those areas. So it's all combination of both. It's not that the whole humankind will get sort of wiped out. I don't think we are there anywhere right now. We are not in a Terminator era right now. So that's too far beyond my imagination right now. So.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. It was indeed a very interesting and interactive session. Thank you so much for joining with us today. So, thank you so much. Now it's time to welcome our next speaker of the session. I'm honored to welcome Mr. Jaykin Dedhia. He completed his graduation degree in Electrical and Electronics Engineering from Mumbai University. He's the founder of DiCam, with more than 5 years of experience in IoT and machine vision. They do robotic process automation using computer vision and AI with the aim of effectively manages operations and compliance without having much dependency on manpower. So we welcome you, sir, and I request you to take the session forward.
Hello, Shivani. It is really nice to be in this event as a speaker, and I'm really feeling very good too about this. So thank you for giving me the opportunity to, you know, keep my thoughts forward, basically. So first of all, I'll just give my short introduction. So in 2013, I started my first startup. So DiCam is my second startup, basically. So in first startup, I was into pure hardware designing. So we were developing different projects, IoT projects for some of our clients. So from 2013 to 2016, we were doing pure hardware designing and IoT stuff. Then in 2016, we got one project in which there was a combination of hardware and computer vision, basically. So we worked on that project for 6 to 7 months. And at the end of 7th month, I realized that computer vision is actually a future of CCTV industry, basically. So there are many flaws which I, you know, in the CCTV market, basically. So there are two kind of flaws which I saw in the market. First is a normal, on a practical implementation point of view, I'm saying. So the first major flaw is majorly SMEs and small shops install the CCTV cameras in their shops, but they don't monitor it manually, right? So in that case, if suppose theft is happened, then after some hours of theft, the man comes to know that the robbery has happened. And then even if he gets the footage, the robber is obviously escaped, right? So in that case, this is the major flaw for SMEs and small businesses. And in case of banking and very high security agencies, they have a command center who is monitoring the whole CCTV cameras. They have a team of some hundreds of people and they monitor the cameras remotely, right? They monitor 24/7, but ultimately it is a human who is monitoring the cameras, right? So in that case, there are many. So one human is monitoring around, say, 50 to 60 cameras minimum. So in that case, obviously any human cannot monitor the camera continuously, or he cannot do a monotonous task continuously. So there actually needs arises of some technology or some mechanism which can automate the process of monitoring, manual monitoring. So that's how, you know, I found this gap in the CCTV industry. So that's how I thought that we would pivot to artificial intelligence and computer vision especially. Then we pivoted in computer vision in 2017, and our whole team started as a core, you know, computer vision company. And we worked for 1 year, and then we found that even computer vision has its limitations. So the major limitation of a computer vision technology is it requires a very high computing power. That any computer vision algorithm or any AI algorithm requires a relatively high computing power, which makes a product very, you know, high cost. So basically it requires some, hello? So it requires some GPUs and I mean everything. So the product cost becomes high. So our aim was to, you know, make AI possible for a normal common man. So, but this, through this, we realized that it is little difficult for a common man to, you know, get this technology. So, the first problem which we faced was a high computing power. Due to this, the cost was really very high. Second problem was it is not a scalable tech. So it requires a very high skilled labor to implement any project to a client's premises, right? So in that case, what we realized was every time we do a project, it requires the same amount of labor, the same amount of high skilled labor. But that is the major benefit of a CCTV market, where even a local electrician can fit and configure the camera. Right, so that is why the CCTV is seen everywhere in our premises, in our buildings, in our offices. Everywhere there's a CCTV. The only reason why CCTV is there, because it has created the whole ecosystem where it has enabled the normal local electrician to configure the camera and to install a camera. Right, so that is why it is very scalable. But this is not the case in computer vision technology. So that is why we, you know, brainstormed a lot for at least 6 to 7 months, and then we jotted down some factors which we want to achieve as a company to build the ecosystem and to make AI possible for every common man. So that is how we, you know, listed some factors. So in this case, the first thing, we as an entrepreneur, not as a company, I am talking as an entrepreneur, we as an entrepreneur have to do that is to build an ecosystem around the computer vision technology or AI technology, so that it becomes very easy for anybody, any unskilled labor, to install the product. So in that case, there are various hierarchies, obviously, for a product deployment cycle. So first is the R&D team and a development team, which is obviously a very high skilled team, which knows all the core programming languages and all. Once the product is developed by that team, it goes to a sales team. Now, sales team are non-technical guys, obviously, from a commercial background or a techno-commercial background. So they are not that acquired to the technology. So they require a good interface or user experience to demonstrate the product to the end customer, right? Now, these two teams are in-house team. Anybody can have it in-house, but the third team, which is an installation team, this plays a very important role in the ecosystem, because the installation team is the one who will take your product to the end customer, right? So in that case, we need to design a product in such a way that it reaches the end customer, it becomes very easy for a normal electrician to install a product without our support, right? So in that case, this usually is a third party company which we give the contract to. So this is a difficult area for a computer vision to survive, basically, in a common scenario right now. And fourth is a support team. The support team also many a times is a third party team, because for a large scale support, it requires a lot of labor, which is obviously I mean, a costly affair. So that is why we outsource the support to some company. So the product should be designed in such a way that it should be properly, you know, the support team should be able to give a proper support to the end customer. So due to these things, the computer vision is little lacking right now. But if we create the ecosystem in which all the four teams are, you know, can use the product easily, can install the product easily, then we can easily implement the computer vision technology or any AI technology to the end customer, to the customer who is, from a non-technical background, right? As the first is ecosystem, second is the cost of the product. Obviously, due to the high computing power, we require a very high amount of GPU servers. So there are currently the companies which are dealing with computer vision works only on two models. First is the cloud-based computing, where they take the feed from the from the client's premises to the cloud, and then they process the feed on the cloud. Now, this again is a very costly effect, because if we take a normal AWS account, it requires, first of all, it requires a GPU server to deploy the system first. Second, it requires a complete bandwidth to take your feed from the ground to the server, right? So that again is a costlier process for the enterprise level. A normal customer, a normal retail customer will have a 100 Mbps bandwidth due to, current scenario for 5G and all, but in enterprise level, it is very difficult to attain this kind of bandwidth, right? So this is again a costlier effect. Out of this, the deployment of the system again is required a skilled labor, a very high skilled labor. So that is also a challenging area here. So due to this, the cost of the product increases. Now, what we did was, we are core. So obviously, I have a personal experience of 5 years in IoT space and hardware designing. So that is why we pivoted into edge-based computing. So we are still a computer vision company, but now we focus more on edge-based computing, where currently the ecosystem of NVIDIA is quite developed, so that, you know, to enable us to take the edge-based computing to a very commercial level, thanks to NVIDIA in that case. So we thought that we will not do pure software or pure AI. We'll combine the hardware capabilities and the AI together, and then we'll come out with the product in which we'll try to develop the ecosystem. We'll try to make as cheap product as possible. And with a good output, basically. So this is how we planned the whole product. So that is why the whole vision of the DICAM is to create a strong ecosystem around computer vision product, thereby making AI possible for every common man. So if I say every common man, that means actually every common man, you and me, should be able to install a normal small AI camera in our homes. That's our vision, basically. So that's it from my side. And again, I would just like to, you know, the entrepreneurs which are there here listening to me, I would just like to give some advices to them. First, if you are building any product, then find the pain points or a gap in the existing system or technologies which is they're working currently, and try to fill the gap or try to fill the pain, try to solve the pain points of that the existing system which is already developing working. And secondly, don't just develop a product. So currently we are also planning the product in such same way. So we are developing a product, we are developing a hardware, we are developing a AI mechanism around it, but also we are developing some services around that product, so that, you know, it can on an entrepreneurial level, it can give a more monthly recurring revenue than any other product. So that's it from my side. And once again, very thanks to have me here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. So if anyone wants to ask any questions, so you can add it in the chat box. Okay, so we have one question from Nishant Kanwar. So he has written that, sir, in India, there are lots of companies like Boat and Patron, which import the goods from China and then markets the product in India under their brand in order to minimize the cost of production. So yeah. What do you think about it?
So in that case, obviously, currently in India, I don't think personally that the scenario is a make in India right now. But obviously, we are on a vision to make everything in India. But currently, obviously, it is not possible due to many things. But yeah, so this is currently the way. But the main important thing is to combine the hardware and the software. So that is the key. If the hardware, anyone can import from anywhere, but the core software, the software which will work and which will create a product is our own proprietary, should be our own proprietary software. That's what I would like to say.
Okay, so there's one question more. What are the procedures according to Indian government to have a startup?
According to what? Sorry.
So what are the procedures according to the Indian government to have a startup?
I mean, there's no such procedure as well. You just need to register a company. You just need to, if you are a startup, then you have a good idea and good product, then you can register in a Startup India. But for registering in Startup India, it requires a lot of patents and proprietary stuff, basically. Register in MSME council as well, so that you know you get the benefits of the MSME sector as well. So that's not, I mean, once we do all this, then it's easy to start a startup. That's not an issue. But to start a startup is not an issue, but to survive and to grow is again an issue. And it all depends on us and our plan of action, how we go about it. So that's the main key.
Yes, so definitely. So there's one question. So where you have raised the funds for the startup?
Currently, we are self-funded. Actually, we have not raised funds for the startup. So yeah, we are looking for the investment as well.
So this is our last question. So what are your comments on digital twin technology and the 5G network? Companies are focusing more on it. So how can we prepare on such ideas?
It's a good thing. I mean, 5G is already, 5G is not different than a 4G. It's just a little, the speed increases and everything. The bandwidth, yeah, in computer vision, if suppose current approach, if we take and if we, you know, take the feed to the cloud, then 5G may help us a lot, in bandwidth thing. But rest, everything remains same. Yes.
Okay. So there's one question. So what about the issue of privacy of data that revolves around artificial intelligence and security applications?
So many companies don't prefer their own data to be, get on cloud. So in that case, there are many ways to protect the data. So usually what we do with banks and everything is we take the data to a secure tunnel and then we, transmit the data to their own cloud so that, anywhere the internet will not come into picture. So that's where the edge computing plays a very important role, because the data is also safe within the edge device itself, and it can be easily configured to connect to a private network which will not go on the internet.
Okay, so thank you so much. It was an indeed honor to hear from you today. Thank you so much for sharing your experience and your thoughts. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So we can't have Mr. Ankit Lekra, sir, with us because of his busy schedule. So we have Ms. Dula Sharma. She is an R&D strategy consultant and at Incubic, responsible for helping universities, corporations and startups in taking right R&D and patent related decisions. So it's my privilege to welcome you, ma'am, and I request you to take the session forward.
Hi, Shivani. Thank you. And hello, everyone. Good evening. This is Mridula Sharma, and I am a R&D strategy consultant with Incubic. I did my BTech from Amity University, Noida, and I have an experience of more than 7 years in the IP industry. So the today's presentation will be a brief on artificial intelligence. And in this presentation, we will be basically covering a brief history of artificial intelligence, current research trends, and the impact of AI on the future. Can you please move to the next slide? So first of all, we'll start with what is the role of mathematics and the history of mathematics, what it can teach us about the future of AI. So it goes back to 1960s, where there were two researchers, David Gale and Lloyd Shapley. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay. So yeah, as I was telling you, there were these two researchers, David Gale and Lloyd Shapley, and they started working on a very unusual topic back then, which was matchmaking. So what they did was they just used a simple maths for sorting and finding the best match. And this algorithm, known as Gale-Shapley algorithm, won the Nobel Prize in 2012. That was not the end of this algorithm. Currently, all these speed dating apps that are being used, you more or less use this algorithm. And it's not only being used in that dating app, but it is also being used by hospitals for finding matching kidney donors, and it has already saved many, many lives. So basically what we want to say is that mathematics is at the core of artificial intelligence. Can we move on to the next slide? So Alan Turing actually was one of the first scientists to question if machines were intelligent, which is actually a very simple but interesting thing that we should be knowing. Are machines intelligence? So he wrote a paper which was titled Computing Machines and Intelligence. It was published in the 1950s paper, and there was just a simple question which was the basis of this paper. And that question was, humans use available information as well as reason in order to solve problems and make decisions. So why can't machine do the same thing, right? And in this paper, Turing discussed how to build intelligent machines and how to test their intelligence. It was a very simple test which was devised by him called the Turing test. The test was basically, if a machine can trick a human into thinking it is human, then it has intelligence. Simple enough, right? But there were actually a few roadblocks which stopped his work in between. So basically these problems were that back then, right? We're talking about 1950s, okay? So in 1950s, computers were very expensive, as we all must know. It could cost almost around 200,000 USDs a month, and only big corporation and universities back then could afford them. And the other problem was basically that the computers at that time could not store any data, and they could only execute commands that were fed to them. So there was a very short amount of memory that was available. Okay, so these were the basic problems that were faced by Turing, and because of which his work was hindered. Next, we'll take a look at the major events in the artificial intelligence. So some of these were, like, for example, John McCarthy. This is between 1957 to 1974, which was a great time for AI, because all of a sudden it captured everyone's interest, and all of, as you can see in the timeline, there was a lot of activity that happened between this whole time space. So some of the major events were such as John McCarthy coined the term artificial intelligence. Computers could store more information, which we, as discussed before, it was a problem. And because there were it could store more information, they become faster, cheaper, and more accessible. Machine learning algorithms also improved, and people got better at knowing which algorithm to apply to their problem. Neuroscientists helped in deep learning techniques, which allowed computers to learn user experience. And in 1997, Garry Kasparov was defeated by IBM's Deep Blue, a chess-playing computer program, which was, I must say, a very remarkable event in the AI intelligence timeline. And of course, the introduction of Moore's Law. Coming to the present and moving, there was a bit of a slow time for the AI research, research and technology, but since the early 2000s, there has been a rapid development in artificial technology again. So as we can see, if you come to 2020s, robotic household cleaners to virtual personal assistants like Siri and Alexa, there has been a huge development, as we can say. And of course, there was this very famous match between Go champion Lee Sedol in South Korea and DeepMind's AI computer program AlphaGo. So there, it was a 5-series match, and actually AlphaGo won 4-1. Okay, so Go is a very South Koreans are like really passionate about this game, just as Indians are passionate about cricket. And so just to save South Koreans into entering depression, AlphaGo lost one of the matches. So we can see how far away we have actually come when it comes to artificial intelligence. And AI is transforming our lives right now. It is everywhere, from transportation to farming, education, and healthcare. Former Google Brain leader and Baidu chief scientist Andrew Ng has said, we may be in an eternal spring of AI. Moving on to innovation trends and pattern. So basically, as we saw in the timeline, the past decade, it has been transformative for AI, and it is evolving at a very, very rapid speed. So how can we, what is another way of understanding these trends? Patents are the answer to it. You can find it all there. Okay, so for example, you know, one of the application area is transportation, right? And please move to the previous slide only. Basically one of the most researched area for transportation comes under autonomous decision making process. So as we can see in this patent filing trend, we can see the patent activity that is happening in this sector of autonomous decision making process. And there was a continuous rise from 1974, but as we saw that around 2013, there was a dip in the research activity. Not much was being done, but then again, since 2018, there has been a rapid rise, and there is a lot of we can see a research happening in under this area. And as far as commercial applications are understood, there's always a gap between patent filing and the technology coming into the market. So it is estimated to be around 5 years. But since COVID happened, we think there may be a acceleration in the adoption of this technology. Next slide, please. We can also, from these patent research technology, we can also see who are the current top players who are most actively researching in this field. So these are Toyota, Ford, and Honda. And an interesting fact is that out of 9,100 patents received by IBM inventors, so IBM is known to have the largest patent portfolio. And in 2018, they received around 9,100 patents, and almost 1,600 patents, or nearly, that is like around roughly 18% of those patents were actually AI related. Previous slide, please. Next slide. So what is the future look like, right? Future is autonomous, okay, and machines will evolve and automate almost all tasks that human do. We can see AI is empowering the ability of for autonomous operation of all types. There are like major, there are no major industry that has not impact, has not been impacted by the modern AI. So, for example, as we can see, the major two major industries that AI has impacted is transportation and healthcare. As far as transportation is concerned, it may take more or less a decade to perfect it, but they will one day ferry us from place to place. And healthcare is comparatively an AI nascent field, okay? And but since, you know, as we saw in COVID, we need a more faster and quick and accurate way for the diagnosis and the drug discovery and monitoring of patients. And of course, these patients, or each and every case produces a lot of data. So that big data analysis is, you know, it's going to help to create a more personalized patient experience. And apart from that, it is estimated that AI systems will generate around $6.7 billion in revenue from healthcare globally. These were the two major industries. Apart from that, there are other major industries such as manufacturing, mining, construction, energy, entertainment, space, and ocean exploration that will be impacted, that have been impacted by AI and which has a high potential. So, what are the possibilities of future? Next slide, please. So basically, I feel that ethics along with government organizations and research institutes will play a key role in determining our future. But even that being said, there are a lot of questions right now. For example, security, right? How do we keep AI safe from adversaries? For example, autonomous weapons, right? If there are autonomous weapons in the hand of a wrong person, they can easily cause mass casualty there if there's going to be a race for AI arms and ultimately which would lead to AI war. So as of now, like it is said in this age and era, the next type of war will not be fought physically or with bombs, but with how good the other countries you're able to get and hack into system. It will be a cyber war, and AI would, of course, be a major determining factor in it. Apart from that, how are we going to handle the mass unemployment if AI is going to do every work for us? And how do machines affect our behavior and interaction? That is another good question that we still need to find answers to. So this was about AI and its trends, but how does AI help, what is the part of AI in the human evolution? Next slide, please. So, next slide. In 2018, there was this Chinese scientist, Jian Kui, and he announced that he had created twin girls with a gene editing advanced CRISPR technology. So to give you an idea, CRISPR is basically a gene editing technology, which is a collaboration between computer scientists and biologists. So there, this is a big ethical question. First of all, as we know, creating human clones and then again, gene edited babies. It raised a lot of backlash from the scientific community and other people as well. But if we talk about gene editing, there may be positive outcomes such as genes that might cause disease or, you know, editing in genes that could create a high yielding drop resistant crop. Okay. But as I mentioned previously, what scientist Jian Kui did raised a lot of backlash because it introduces a complex ethical and moral and legal implication. And this could include threats to privacy and confidentiality, informed consent and patient autonomy. So
ma'am, I guess you're muted and you are not audible.
And are we responsible enough to handle it? Thank you. Hello, am I audible?
Yes ma'am, you are audible.
Thank you. That will be all from my side for today.
Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. So if anyone wants to ask any question, please you can add it in like on the chat box. Okay, so till then, ma'am, there's a question like what about the like issue of privacy of data, like data that revolves around AI? So what can like what is the issue of this, and what can we do like for this issue?
Privacy, data privacy has always been a concern, whether it is with AI or any other kind of platform, right? As of now, the only way to do that is that the responsibility of providing that confidence actually solely is on the vendor who is giving you the services. I believe that. Okay, and from our side, from a customer's perspective or a user's perspective, I would say that they just have to trust with the security and the technology that their service provider is giving.
Okay, ma'am. So, ma'am, there's another question. That is, how far you see AI industry development being added in India?
So if we talk about India, right now this there's a huge potential in India for the AI industry development, especially in the Medicare and healthcare sector. There's this startup from Bangalore called Niram AI, and they have actually created an application that uses simpler methods. So for example, breast cancer detection. Breast cancer is, the test methodology, the mammography is a very, very painful process for the patients, and it's not easily detectable as well. Some of the time that patients get diagnosed, it has been already too late. So they are using AI technology to identify the breast cancer tissues faster and in an effective manner and earlier. So yeah, and they are one of the most they are coming under the top biomedical AI technology startups right now. So seeing that, and there are many other examples, I think AI industry development is going to be it's going to be big in India.
Okay, ma'am. So, like, relating to this question only, like, how can we make sure that India really like benefits from artificial intelligence in agriculture sector and is cost effective as well?
Okay. So as I told you about CRISPR, okay, it's a gene editing tool, right? And they're also using AI in it to have better results. And as I told in the discussion as well, gene editing is one way of producing, better resistive crops, right? For example, drought resistant crop. The whole onus right now lies on the adoption of the technology, but as well as development. If see more people come and develop technology related AI technology for crops, and there are a lot of startups that are getting into this right now, as we can see from the startup landscape, and a lot of in fact a lot of patent application filing is also being done for this. So
yes, ma'am. So, like, what can we do to make Indian startup competitive with Microsoft and Google?
I'm sorry. What do you mean by competitive with Microsoft and Google? In which sense? In innovation and research sense, or monetary wise?
We will take it monetary wise or innovation or. So ma'am, if we will talk about the both the aspects, so like Indian startup can be competitive with Microsoft or Google, and how can we make sure that it will be?
See, innovation wise, definitely anyone can be as competitive as they can come up to that level with Microsoft and Google. Microsoft and Google were, well, even for that example, IBM, what was Microsoft before when IBM existed? Microsoft was nothing. It was a garage company. Okay, but they had an innovative idea which changed everything. Then came in Google. Google with its search engine. There was this time when Yahoo wanted to buy it, and they wanted to sell to Yahoo, but Yahoo didn't buy them. And then the sides were turned. It was Google who was going to buy Yahoo. So it was because of that great innovative idea. And coming to more recent times, Facebook, it was a simple idea. And I think with innovation, it does not matter how big or small you start. You can always become a giant. And a very good way to understand these new research trends, current ongoing researches, and the researches already existing, we believe that patents are actually a gold mine to get that information from.
Yes, ma'am, definitely. So ma'am, if you can give a brief information or about Incubix, so if you can elaborate about Incubix.
Basically Incubix is a deep tech technology company wherein I'm getting some issues.
You're audible.
Sorry. So basically our company has worked with India's top universities and organizations in the United States. Incubix is all about, as I told you, patents are a gold mine for information and understanding the current global innovation and research trends. So what we do is we enable our users to make informed research and business decisions driven by IP. We are creating an IP intelligence software that would help everyone. Does not matter you're a startup or you're a big firm, it will benefit you to create your own research and development strategy. So basically with our proprietary AI technologies, and we have a deep expertise in IP management and analytics, we are providing individuals and organizations to easily access and utilize the patent knowledge. You don't need to be an expert to understand patents, but you do need some sort of expertise to access that information and take out meaningful insights. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to remove that gap. Any layman person with a particular idea can just go and use our AI engine and understand what is going on in the research front.
So ma'am, there's a relative question from the question that I asked recently was that what is your opinion? Should be the focus of the companies to cope up with the jacket of competencies of the economy.
Right now, basically, I think, apart from having an idea, you should always be updated according to the current requirements that are going around. Right.
Yes. So, ma'am, there's one question that once artificial general intelligence is achieved, they say that this is the last problem man has to ever solve. So, is artificial general intelligence just a complex math problem, or there's something else to it?
See, I think mathematics is a core of artificial intelligence, as we discussed, but at the same time, that is just to find to I think that is just there to perfect it, to find a perfect way to create that technology, right? But just the knowledge aspect of it, the working aspect of it, is not complete without, you know, handling those ethical issues. If we are not able to solve those ethical issues alongside the solving or the perfection of mathematics related to it, I think it's not just that much. It's not just about a complex math problem that has to be solved. There are other external factors, such as the ethical issues I was talking about, that is also a requirement.
Okay, ma'am, thank you so much. If you have okay, so I just wanted to let you guys know that we have also Akash Surekar sir here. So if you want to ask any question, like with ma'am or sir, you can ask it like in the chat box right now. I'll convey it. Okay, so there's a question. Okay, so guys, our next speaker will be here in a few minutes. Till then, if you want to ask any question, you can put it in on the chat box. Till then, there's a question that ma'am or sir, that AI is taking, artificial intelligence is taking over the manpower, right? So, which leads to unemployment. So how do you feel that we can face such challenges in the future?
So I think this is Akash. I briefly answered that question after my talk, right? So the best way to overcome that is that we need to upskill in different categories. And that upskilling could be anything. So upskilling could be for tech people, non-tech people. So they can learn about the new jobs which will come out. As I said right now, for example, in drones, there are new jobs category who can manage drones. There will be new category to manage equipment. There will be new category to manage machines, right?
Yes.
So I think there will be new jobs which will come out, which will be impacted. The categories where it will be impacted. I think those categories where people are, they need to upskill themselves, right? And I think as long as they can upskill themselves, I don't think there will be an issue, because they'll always find new jobs to take,
yes,
and this is always a cycle, right? So you lose jobs in certain categories, you gain jobs in certain categories, and there's always a cycle. I mean, for example, today hardly people ask for Scala programming, hardly people ask for Google programming, right? People are now asking for Python. So they will not get jobs. And similarly in any other category, even if it's a non-tech category, right? So it's all about how do you upskill, and then how do you make sure that you are fit for the new requirements. I think the world is changing. We have to keep on changing as well. And as everyone says in an essay, every day is a new day. So
definitely, sir. Thank you so much. And thank you so much, ma'am. It was an amazing to learn and hear you. Thank you for being here, and it was an indeed honor.
Thank you, Shivani. Thank you for having me. And it was a great experience for me as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. So now I welcome our next speaker, Mr. A. Atif Shah, founder and chairman of ABE Semiconductor Designs. He has started as lecturer and now playing the role of chairman, technocrat, and most importantly, the combination of teacher and the industrialist. With a span of 15 years of journey, leading nearly 40 plus research team across the nation, designed nearly 50 plus technology transfers, ABE Semiconductor Designs has now playing the major role in the development of artificial intelligence solutions for various clients across the globe. Specialized in machine and deep learning formulations to the problems, developing the AI mobile apps, and mostly fusing the artificial intelligence with the different IoT devices. I welcome you, sir, and I request you to take the session forward.
Yeah, very, very good evening to one and all here. Is my voice audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for this team, Think India team, for giving me this opportunity to share experience on artificial intelligence. Not only on artificial intelligence, I want to share some of the experience as a startup journey when we build up an AI-based products and what we face it and what is the real stuff which is behind the AI-based mechanism. So this is very quite interesting sessions. I'm going to divide this session into three important points. One is how we build up the system with the AI ecosystem in a company. If you're aware about all these sort of things, if you are being interested to start your own startup, and if you want to go for a job, then it will be good. And then how to learn your ML? How do I learn it actually? So how I do learn it, and what are all the applications we developed it for, and mechanism, and what is the general thing which you have to come across here? And third is about a simple product, because when everyone talks about AI. AI has been normally utilized for a kind of a machine and to machine make machine intelligence, right? So, but in our case, we developed an AI for, and we implement an AI for something else. I'll just discuss you with a lot of the future products which are there. And hopefully, if you can be in the part of the team, I'll be happy. So first thing is let me share some of my experience with you. Shall I share it actually? Is there a sharing content, ma? Actually,
yes, sir.
Yeah, can you share it? Actually, can you on it? Right, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So hope my video, my website is being seen by everyone else. Let me introduce myself. This is Atif Shah from ABE Semiconductor Designs. You may have a problem everybody been puzzled what is semiconductor and what is AI. So what we are very specialized is we just develop the AI algorithms, not only with algorithm, we just deploy the algorithm on different hardness. We deploy on machines, we deploy on any system so that it can be a more intelligent one. So as the what happened is when we started the journey of AI, before that we have been working on an embedded system and we are working on a different kind of a hardware. And now we are the AI rules the picture, we just combine this AI for a different application. So this is what our logic is. And we are the team of 20 actually. And we are just developing a lot of stuffs with a lot of clients actually. And we do develop a mobile apps on AI mechanism. So this is how we are, and we are just have a tagline for this. We are the craziest people in the world to develop cognitive AI solution and create a new AI hardware with a lot of applications which we are making out. When you see you can see my lot of beards and everything, because we used to talk only with machines, not on the humans, right? We just talk only to the humans only on Sundays, but all the 6 days we used to work on the machines actually, right? So this is how we work actually. So this is about the brief introduction. Like, I'll share you one story which is behind the startup, because like you may get inspired about this, the building of this startup. So this is a brief introduction, and then like want to make it like when you go for an AI. So I don't want to stop only with kind of AI application, because how do you learn an AI? You can see a lot of courses before moving on to AI. I want to make you to understand what is AI is and where it has all been applied for and what are the job opportunities and what are the things. So first thing is about when you have an AI is being considered for your application. The first and foremost thing what you have to understand clearly is the AI is not only utilized for an application, though like many of the speakers would have told you about it. It is for a life. But here, I just justify the AI is used in healthcare, and most importantly, cyber security. Because when you work on a cyber security, like the most important thing is when the IoT comes into the picture, you have to make it like a lot of attacks and security flaws there. And in order to overcome this, there we have an AI. And second, third important is we want to develop an AI for an educational platform system. So now, you know, like we are in need of a good teachers. Sorry to say this, right? We are in need of a good teachers actually and good mentors. So now the AI has been implemented on education system, and even AI can be utilized in your cooking system, right? In your cooking, right? So when you talk about AI, it is not being implemented only one area. It is a diversified area where I want to make an intelligent machine so that I can able to make a replicate of the human thinking. But it is not so actually. You can't do that actually, but still we are working on that kind of an area. So the AI, let me have a general mechanism what you can know for the AI. This is the thing which you can apply the AI for any algorithms. For example, when you want to apply for the cybersecurity, you can do it. When you want to apply for an IoT, you can do it. And when you want to apply for any kind of vehicular networks, because in a smart city, we have in a concept called vehicular transportation system where you can apply for this. And moreover, other than the image processing, you can deal with the signal processing also. So when you want to calculate all these things, I'll consider this as the block diagram, or this is a general working mechanism where you can start doing it. So first, I just talk about simple thing, how to make it out like. The first part is about the data collection, where about we are missing over here. What scenarios we are working over here is we are just working on the predefined data. What is the data which is in the benchmarks and everything? But I suggest you to go for a real-time data collection. For example, when you want to develop a system for the cooking, right? We need a real-time system. So we need a real-time data collection in which IoT comes into the picture. So this is how the real-time data is considered. So instead of considering all the data which is there in the case, we should work on the real-time data, and we must design the data model, and then which we have to do a lot of application on pre-processing, feature extraction and everything. And now like after making out here is we have a database collection, and database collection from that we'll just go for a mathematical of feature extraction which represents your characteristics, and then we'll go for a machine or a deep learning. And nowadays we work on reinforcement. That is most important case here. We work on the hybrid algorithm such as the deep reinforcement logic, where I combine the deep learning as well as the reinforcement technique of learning into a single system, and then I'll go for a decision box. So what is happening in the decision box is we will just stop the algorithm. When you do a coding in Python, right, what we do is we just code on the Python with the help of a TensorFlow or a PyTorch or anything else. You just do the code and we check only with accuracy. But it is not so to be done here. So first you have to understand, once you start doing it, you have to understand clearly that you need to go for a decision box in which I have to test it on my real-time scenario. If you have trained, if you have collected hundreds of data, train the hundreds of data and make it in a real-time scenario so that what happens, how the behavior, how it learns by itself, that can be understood clearly by the help of a machine. So this is how the logic which is going to be taking place. You can integrate anything. I'll give the thrust areas which is going to be happen. First is cybersecurity. The first and foremost thing is about the side channel attacks, right? The side channel attacks has been going to implement, like it has been, it's creating a serious threat in our IoT system. Why? Because you can able to trace the data with the help of your concept on the power traces. If you can read the power traces from the device, you can able to read the data. So this is the problem, and this is how the AI is going to be utilized here. So in order to predict what is the attack is going to on the IoT sector and how it rectifies, this is the thing. And here comes a new mechanism of artificial intelligence. We call this chaos based artificial intelligence. Please refer this. This is going to be the new trend in your cybersecurity. That is a chaotic artificial intelligence. So this is one time you can do it. Oh, the second application, what we come across here is, please make sure about when you are been focusing on cybersecurity, please select your this side channel attacks, working on side channel attacks, which is a real time scenario, which is happening. And second thing is about learn a chaotic artificial intelligence, which is most important, right? And the second thing is about medical healthcare system. We are in the process of developing the predictive analysis for the different diseases. When you go for like a smart implementation, like smart devices, for example, and when you consider about your COVID-19, we are working on a scenario like where the persons are wearing a mask, or like whether the social distancing is maintained, everything, right? So that is the most important thing where the wearable devices comes into the picture. So when you go for a smart healthcare, this is one kind of an application. And second is about the prediction of the diseases. So I tell you a device, please refer it. There is a device which is we are working on it, like it is nothing but the prediction of what you called as the epilepsies from the body. That is epilepsies, that is your, which will cater stroke. It will predict even before 1 hour, right? The devices are designing like it will even predict the stroke within 1 hour, before the 1 hour. So the accuracy algorithms are main being here, and we made it on the cloud analytics, and from the mobile app you can understand, and through the sensors, EEG sensors, and whatever the case you have. And the third thing is about, like, in the smart healthcare system, we have a big scenario which we people are working over here. When you consider 1,000 years or 1,500 years above, right, as ago, actually before 1,000 or 2,000 years ago, there is no kind of an MRI scanning, CT scanning, and you can portals, a PET images, nothing like that, right? So what they did is, like, they are just implementing with the three pulses method. Like, they have three pulses, we call as alpha, beta, gamma. So from these three pulses, they can able to diagnose the human bodies, the diseases in human bodies. So my dear friends, like, if I can list out it, approximate number of human diseases, it will be around 4,489 diseases in our human body, and through which it can be diagnosed through these three pulses, which is being kept in the traditional methodology. Right, when you look out for the Upanishads or Vedas, there are the methods which has been there. And now the AI is being utilized to dig out that kind of an application and to design a smart wearable devices, which will consume less power as well as so intelligent, and it can able to give you the clear cut results. This has been trying out. We are trying out with even like pregnant ladies, where they're just going for a checkup every day. When I fix up the device on their hand, it will give you the clear status of a fetus also. So this is the most advanced research which has been taking place in AI during smart healthcare system. This is the second application. Third application, when you want to go for a vehicular network, vehicular connectivity, right? So here you know about BWM and Mercedes-Benz, and everybody's are utilizing AI actually for a kind of driver assistance system. Not only a driver assistance system, everybody will be aware about the accident detection system. What happens here is, like, it's a traditional system where the drowsiness is detected and it has been rectified. But think about a situation when the car is to be connected with the cloud continuously, and it should able to alert me whenever there is a accident prone area before a 5 kilometers, and the car has to check by itself what is the reason and whether the reason can be eradicated. For example, if the accidents, when I load the history of a data on my cloud, when it runs only for, it tells me like this is an X accident area, and this is due to the speed of 70 kilometer. My car checks itself by whether my speed is been less than 70. So this is how this intelligent driving system is been integrated and connected with the cloud, and the cloud runs numerous of reinforcement and deep learning algorithms, what I told you. So this is a third area. Fourth area is something about the commercial area, where like we need to go for a kind of a home automation, whatever the king, right? And it most importantly, like whatever the problems we face in the home automation can be solved with the help of our AI system. For example, prediction of electricity bills, prediction of your cooking. For example, nowadays, like, I don't think so, the girls will start cooking actually. So what happens here is it is our thing, like we have to start cooking it. So the systems are developed, like you can refer a website called kickstarters.com, where the systems are developed, in which depends upon the quantity what we have in our home. It will take it as an input and it will decide what kind of cooking can be done. So the recipes are prepared based on the cooking, whatever the things you have. So the database data collection is more important, and it takes the real-time data, checks with the database, and it gives you a lot of logic. So here the training is important, and you can update the training with a kind of a deep reinforcement logic. So this is how the fourth application and fifth application, it can be utilized most importantly in electrical vehicles, which can manage the battery management and establishment of communication system and your authentic. And finally, like the charging time, that is the charging time of your prediction of your charging mechanism. So these areas where the EV plays a vital, that is AI plays a vital role in the electrical and hybrid vehicle system. These are the four or five areas, thrust areas where people are working over here. And fifth is about your machine, where we call the industry 4.0, where we go for the predictive maintenance of different machines, because the fault diagnosis and the fault tolerance system is most important. So these are all the nutshell of areas where it is implemented. I've given you an idea also. So you can ask me a question. If this is idea where it has been applied for everybody else, what I can do right now? How to make it? Whether I have to go for courses, I have to go for the learning, all these things. Please keep this block diagram as your mechanism. This is the most important. And this can be applied for any kind of a field. It can be applied for any kind of a field. If you want to learn a kind of ML and DL or artificial intelligence, I suggest you one single point. Because what happens is when you start doing it, this will be your case study, right? When you start exploring what is ML and what is the max begin, because we just do the program and we just develop the codes and we ought to deploy over here and we just do lot of applications. And you are supposed to learn what is the idea behind that and the max behind the solution. So you are, in order to do such a kind of a thing, what will happen? This is the case when you start exploring it. But instead, forget about it. I'll just give you the clear line. This, you have seen this film actually. It is a robot which was released on 2010. It is not like 2.0 which was released. Oh, it is starring Rajinikanth and Aishwarya Rai. If you take this movie, right? If you take this movie, you can learn artificial machine deep learning in 5 hours, right? So if the time permits, I can do it. What is can be done? But still, I want to insist to you. So if you can take this movie and you can picturize it, every learning algorithm is integrated over here. I don't know like what is a coincidence which has been done, but still it employs all sort of your mechanism, all sort of your algorithms which has been there here. So you can take this, watch the movie carefully, and like you can see what is happening in the machine and deep and reinforcement what we talked about and how the algorithms can be formulated. So please take this, watch it again. Don't watch it only for Aishwarya Rai. You will watch it in the perspective of your learning mechanism. So this will play a vital role for you. Okay. So if there is a time, I can explain you how it can be done. Right. So this is how you have to make your AI, because everybody in this country or in the world like looking for an AI, developing an algorithm max. So AI is very simple, right? It is not so complex. It is very simple, but provided if you can understand what is happening, right? So this is the thing. So develop an AI not only for a medical image processing, but it can be applied for the all the diversified fields which I told you. And the next point what I want to share with is like when my company was being started, right? It is something like quite opposite to AI, right? When my company was being started, like, so what is the expectation from the people like you, right? From the industry, are people like us, like we are working vigorously on this. And to be frank with you, we have a lot of demand for this. If you want to like, if you are starting a startup, I'll tell you what is the journey. And if you want to go for a job, there is also a thing which has been expectation. So first thing is about, I just suggest you to go for a positive attitude. That is most important in case of when you start a startup or when you want to go for a job, you should have the positive attitude. So I'll tell you one important story actually, right? Apart from this AI, right? Why AI comes into this? This is also an artificial intelligence in a life history actually, right? When we started a company, like, you know, like starting a company, it is like making a most committing a crime, right? When you start a company, right? When you go and inform your parents that you want to start your company, right? The society, even parents and even nobody will encourage you. This will happen, right? So this is the most important crime in our country, actually. Not in our country, anywhere, right? It's an important crime, right? And beyond that, when you start your company against all the odds, and the people around you will be like looking forward that, like, when you are going to be like fall down, when you are going to face any challenges. And one such challenge which I faced is like, you know, like in the 2015, my company is situated in Chennai. Like in 2015, like in the December, this is the same month or November or December, my company was washed out with the whole floods, right? My company was completely washed out with the complete floods, actually. I still remember like my servers and my boards like was been floating on my water, on the water. I still looked out for that. I was been looking. I still remember when the November and December month comes into my mind, I just used to like, I just used to think about what are the problems we faced it, actually. So that was abnormal month for me, actually. I couldn't came out because all my inventions, innovations, and everything was being washed out. Simply washed out, right? So like what happens is like, what's the, there is a point actually, like we don't have a money to make it up. So what happens is at that, it was a growing time, started in 2011. And the 4 years of time, like, you know, like we have invested a lot of things and everything was dumb stuck. We have been sucking out, actually. So against all the crime, you have, against all the odds, you have started your company as a crime. And now, like, it was being washed out, right? Now you can imagine, right? The man who has started against all the odds, like what the people or the society will tell you like that, right? So it's a thrust which is given to you, right? It's a complete thrust which is given to you. I cannot able to imagine, like, because we have only two options. One, to quit the industry and quit it and quit my startup and just to go for a job, because I need to repay the lot of things which is, because I was being zero and I was a bankrupt. My account was minus 2000 something else. I used to maintain for this minus account for next 2 years. I'll just tell you the other story. So I was bankrupt. So what to start it? Whenever you go and help, like whenever you go and ask the help, nobody will help you out when you start an industry. That's another problem what we have, right? So like what we thought, what I thought is whether to start it or whether to quit it. So this is what the thing is in my mind. So many of us will quit it, right? This will happen, right? Because you have to repay the customer's mechanism and you have to take care about your food, shelter and everything. And you have to repay the customers and you have to take care of your employees. Rent of an office building, everything is on your mind, and still everything is in water, right? And the investments are done, and we have to repay the investments. Without a product, we can't do it. So these are all the problems which is running on my mind. So definitely, like, we have to quit it. Actually, this is the scenario which everyone takes. But instead, I restarted, right? Instead, I restarted. That was an interesting experience. What I told you, like, I'm a strong believer of Mahadev, actually, Lord Shiva's disciple. I'm a strong believer of it, right? That is what it is called, self-confidence, whatever you call it. Like, we call it as a Lord Shiva, actually. So what I just used to take is, I used to go for the temple, and like I just take a lot of decisions on that, because my major dream project is based on that, actually. So we have not started it, we made it a blueprint on that. So what is logic here is, I went for the temple, actually, on Monday. I still remember, I went for a temple on Monday. I used to like sit, what has happened, like nobody is there to help you out. So, but my instinct is, I have to start it again and again. So my instinct, I never give up, actually. So I want to start the company again and again. So I have intuition to start it, actually. But nobody is there to help you because every doors are shut down, actually. So like what happens is, I went for the temple and I got an instant, okay, we'll start by the company on Wednesday. And provided there is a lump of amount to be done with the something about 10 lakhs, right? I'll just give you the word 10 lakhs, right? So Monday, like morning, I went to the temple, and evening I got a call from somebody else who have just seen me only twice, actually. And he called me and we just talked to him, actually. And he called me to my home and we just talked to him, actually. And we are just, I'm just explaining what is all that happened. And you don't believe it, like he agreed to give a 10 lakhs of payment, actually. So what happens is, he just called me and he gave assurance that he's going to give you a 10 lakhs of payment for you. And I couldn't believe you, because believe me, like, because I was walking on the road, somebody is calling and just giving me the 10 lakhs of amount. So I just asked him, when you are going to give me? And he said on Wednesday. And by Wednesday, by 8:30 a.m., he came to my home and he gave me the packet of a bundle of rupees of 10 lakhs to me. And like with that, we started it. So this is what is called the self-confidence. And this is what is called like the attitude, positive attitude towards everything. We are optimistic, actually. So I have a strong belief on God, actually. I have a strong belief on Lord Shiva, simply, right? And without a document, without an interest, and without even you go for a bank, you need to produce a lot of formalities. But without anything, we got an amount. So what I'm trying to say is, when you believe on you, the universe will answer you, right? This is the most important. When you have a belief on you, I have a belief, like my belief is on Lord Shiva. I have a lot of strong belief. Whenever you see my company's logo, it is in the shape of Lord Shiva. It is in fact, everything, it is on the shape of Lord Shiva, right? So like everything is on the spirituality and basically based on the Lord Shiva, because I have a strong belief. I never like think of a second thought about it. I just used to go for temple, just get the decision, hold it. My board meeting will take place only on temples, not on the five-star hotels, right? My board meeting will take only on the temples. Not, I just tell them my investors, I will not come to any five-star hotels or something, seven-star, just come to this temple, we'll discuss, and before him, just go it. This is what I did. So when you have a self-confidence and we have a belief on you, the universe will help you out. So don't think that nobody is there to help you out. The universe will help you out in any format. That is why we came here. Like after 2016, again in huddles, lot of huddles, formation of team and the running of the team, couldn't deliver in a proper time, everything. And the next 2 years, it was like a learning experience. Like 4 years, like I didn't learn about the business. But after that, we learned the business. What is the business? What is the product? What is the mistakes? Everything. I just learned everything. And by 2018 was a major breakthrough. We got a good project from Tata. And slowly we build up it. And by June 2021, my company is going to be a $1 billion company. So this is what the logic is. So positive attitude reminds everything. So if you decide one thing is go for it. Go for it. Don't go for a second thought. Most probably like the financial crunch and everything will be there. But if you believe on yourself, if you have a positivity on everything, I tell you, like, universe will help you out. Universe, when you ask the universe, it will help you out and you will make it out. The best example is mine, right? You without anything. So I told you, like, I was a bankrupt. By 2016, I was a bankrupt. Now I'm just announcing. I just already announced it. My company will reach by June 2021 as a $1 billion company. So this is how we work actually. So formation of team and everything is to be done. So please believe on yourself. Anybody else, like it is yours, your, and first of all, believe on yourself that you can do it against all the odds. So believe on yourself. Second thing is about learn quickly, right? That is most important. So that's why I told you how to learn it. This is what the logic. So when you learn it, right, don't look forward to traditional YouTube courses. I'm not against all sort of stuff, because when I just interview the guys, right, when with the different scenarios of AI, right, I couldn't find out like the proper thing which they have understood the basic foundation. So learn it in a very simple manner, implement it and check for the solution. So this the picture what I told you, like, please go through it. You will learn lot of things. If the time permits, I can able to sit with you for 3 hours and I make you to learn what are the each and everything, right? I can make an operation over this film and you can see practically how it is implemented. So learn quickly. That is most important, and fail quickly. This is most important. When you do some algorithms, fail quickly. Nothing wrong in it. So don't afraid of failing it actually, right? And the fourth important, most important point is follow ethics in life. This is most important, because I find like whatever you do, I don't believe on the Newton's third law as far as the Newton when the life is considered. Because I told you, like, when you have a positive attitude, universe will give you everything. And the same way, when you go, when you have a good deeds and good thought, you will be coming in the life. So this is my life principle. Because when we talk about, when my companies talk about, my company doesn't rely on the resumes. I don't believe on resumes. I don't believe on marks. I don't have a marks. Like, I don't have a criteria. Only thing is, you will be like, if you are interested, just come and learn with us. And we will be taking as an intern. If everything is intern goes fine, you will be in the recruitment job. This is what we do actually. We will check only with the passion and attitude. I don't believe on the resumes. I don't believe on the marks. Nothing else, because that cannot be desired. So self-motivation is important and self-identity is important. That we look forward to. And that's why we made our employee as one of the stakeholders in my company, actually. So he's been like joined as an intern. Now he's a stakeholder in our one of the major projects, actually. So this is how we work on it. So I suggest you to follow the ethics in life. Think about the good thoughts, right? And if you have a good thoughts and good deeds, definitely nothing can defeat you. And many of us don't know what is this security. Like, this is most important trivial point in your life. Nobody allows it. When somebody learns it, okay, I just go and learn with the YouTube. Somebody learns with Coursera, go and learn with it. But we don't know what is learning here. So please be with the good thoughts. Because because that will help you out. If you have a good thoughts, universe will be in your hand, because I have personally experienced all these things actually. So there is no kind of a theories actually. It is personal experience what we developed it. And moreover, like when we, as far as my company is concerned, like we used to share the profit among the employees. So this is all because we are just implementing all our policies. Seeing my company is growing in a different scenario, right? So when the profits are with me, like the company is not growing, simply it is not growing. When I share it, when I start sharing with my knowledge, when I start sharing with my all sort of revenues with my employees and all sort of people, like, so what happens is my company's growth is completely different. So please be aware about all these 4 points. This is most important. So please be like, have a self-confident among you. After all, gaining all these things, you can learn AI. AI with this film, and you can come up with some innovative ideas. Without this point, when you learn AI, AI will be an AI. That's all, right? It will not be into a product. So please be positive. Universe can help you out. And most importantly, follow the ethics, right? And most importantly, quick. Learn quickly. That is all the things which I want to share with you, right? So hope you have this, know what is about it. And just share you with some video clip with my product. If anybody can tell me what is about the product, but the product is in secret. So I'll just share you the video, how the AI is going to be utilized in my education system. This is my dream project since I'm a teacher, basically. So like, we want to share you one of the video clip, which is going to rule actually, right? So I just share it 1 minute. So I'll just share some one video actually, like, please look forward to this. So if you have been starting your journey right of a startup, you can develop this. I'm just sharing it with you actually. Yeah, so just watch it out. This is how we are going to design it. So this is why I'm showing here is the AI can be implemented in education system. So to develop an high intelligent teaching methodologies in a platform, and this is going to like, I don't want to reveal this idea because it is under patent actually, right? So this is the logic which you have to think about it. So please make sure that AI is not only for a machine, it can provide a solutions to any problem in any field. So that's the sample which I've showed you. The AI is going to be utilized in an education system. So don't think that AI is going to only for the machine. It can be used for any kind of a mechanism, right? So I've taken a lot of time actually, right? So I can make it out with all sort of stuffs, right? I'll just share my mail ID and all my personal contacts with you. So if any queries and anything, if you want me to make it out, definitely I can go with that. I love students and the journey people, like, because I will used to collaborate with them. And if you can teach me, like, my methodology of teaching is different, and if you can teach me, if you can make me to learn, I'll be happy, right? So I'll share it with you, and any queries you can ask me right now.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really of the for this pilot side, so if I'm like I'm pronounced, pardon me for this. You need this data daily to make it better. Do hospitals provide it, or if no, then how?
And can you repeat it, because your voice is breaking actually?
Okay, so am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Because voice is breaking, I couldn't hear you actually.
So I guess there's a connectivity issue, but I have sent you that question in your chat box. So please look at it.
Okay.
If I am audible.
Yeah, fresh data daily to make it better. Do hospitals provide it? Or okay. So for this kind of epilepsy data, we have, what we do is we used to train in the benchmarks. We have a website called physionet.org, where you can find out the epilepsy data and the brain signal data of the different patients. And that data is trained among the mechanism, and we used to test it with a human. And that too with a ethics following in it, that is, we need to follow the government's rule, so that you have to, there is no kind of a law which can able to make it out. So we need to check it. We need to check it with that. So epilepsy detector, I repeat you, first thing is we'll train with a data set of all the patients, which is available in physionet.org. And the second thing is we used to test with the real-time patients. This is what we do. We never collect the data from the real-time, because that is highly impossible to test it. So just we have the device, test it, what has happened. Very simple.
Okay, sir. So there's no other question, I guess. I can see in the chat. Okay, sir. So everyone is thank you, saying thank you for such an inspiring session. Question, I guess, I think artificial intelligence is the best option for growth in India. I have learned so much about artificial intelligence. So it doesn't come.
Yeah, it's for a growth of country, like AI, blockchain, IoT should come into picture. But my suggestion is the artificial intelligence is the replication of our human brain. And I suggest you to go for, like, what happens is if a human brain is not been trained properly, you can't produce a good AI algorithms. What is happening in today's scenario? When you look out all the children, they have been like playing with the mobile phones, right? They are playing with the mobile phones. What happens is like the thing which we are coming across, we are 90s or 80s kids. We just used to work on the ground. We just play with cricket and a lot of things with stuff. And we now realize the strong body situation. But in the scenario, what we happen in this today's scenario, like everybody's working on a mobile phones. So mobile phones, we should not ban it, the mobile phones, but still we can make a system in which the mobile phones can be utilized as an effective method by the children. So the human intelligence is important. Developing the human intelligence is important to design strong AI algorithms for the welfare of the nation. So it should be starting. It should be started from the foundation, even from the fifth or whatever case, like kids, it should start from the kids. So that is what I was used to suggest it. So AI is important. And other than this, human intelligence is important to produce a good AI, right? That is what is important, right?
Yes, sir. So there's a question that.
Yeah.
Database of like patients for research, like Western countries.
Yeah, it's exactly that. But you have a benchmarks, which I told you, that is like physionet.org will have all sort of benchmarks that can be utilized for the training. And that you can, this is a huge data set, which is of different patients from Europe and US. Everything is available actually, and you can do with that. So there, you can't go and create a data sets, but the universities are providing a real time data sets that is available in physionet.org.
Yes, sir. So as a student of, I want to know artificial intelligence. So how can I do that?
Please watch the movie. please watch the movie again and again and again. You will learn the AI in a 1 week. That's my basic suggestion.
It's a special movie.
You can refer it.
Learning.
Yeah, I'll make it out. If time permits, I can share you my knowledge how to see this movie. Each and every algorithm can be unexplored with the help of this movie and with the mathematical derivation. So within 1 day, they can learn and just see implementation. That's all.
Okay, so I guess there are a lot of questions that everyone asks.
Yeah, yeah.
But so we can take one last question and then we can come to an end. So sir, there's a question that there are many people like me who do not know about like artificial intelligence, mm-hmm. and I have an idea to expand this project. How can I contact you? So sir has already shared the email ID, and of course I guess on LinkedIn, sir, is it possible to contact you?
Sure. I'm happy to be connect with them and help them out. Like that's what I told you. Like if the people can make me to learn, I'm happy.
Okay, some question. So I know. Okay, so if this question is to the current topic, but I would like to ask this question: that what do you think about the ongoing initiative taken by some companies to provide basic coding knowledge to small children at an early age?
Actually, like code, because I registered in some companies, X or Y companies. I attended the classes actually, right? The thing is, like everyone has been like. It's been like having an interest, like everyone is having interest, but the methodology of teaching is important. So this is where we are lagging it actually. So we don't like if I just develop a mobile phone app with the buttons and everything, they will make it and publish in a mobile, that is Play Store, and they will release that I am a developer, I'm a mobile developer. That is not the case is going to happen. So methodology of teaching is important. So I suggest everyone to go for innovative methodology of teaching, methodology of learning, so that you can share your knowledge. This is what the one such thing which I told you is referring your movie. So please, if that can be done, if the students are learning with seeing the movie with Aishwarya Rai, and everybody knows, they will learn the AI with the Aishwarya Rai, right? So like they will learn, okay, they will keep in mind and they will implement it. If I teach them in a mathematical order, like there is a TensorFlow, there is a PyTorch, you have to go for Anaconda, just make it all this stuff, all startup stuff. It will not help you out. So unless you work continuously, if the tool is required, if you can make you to love your subjects, then it's a vital thing.
In San Jose, California. So you wanted to ask that China is way ahead of India in artificial intelligence investments and research. And they are now challenging USA. So in total investments and number of artificial intelligence scientists, so what's your plan for India to catch up?
Yeah, first thing is about India is, when you compare with China or US, India is far, 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 far lagging actually. Why? Because we don't have the company to produce the massive data. We don't have companies to get massive data. If the data are not, there is no kind of an artificial intelligence. So, first point is like we need to have a data analytics company or a data generation company, and that kind of a division I'm just focusing on this, like, and moreover that data generation should not violate the rules also. So this is what is most important. The first setup is the data mechanism, and second thing is about we need a people and we need a scientist who can formulate a new algorithm, such as when you talk about AlexaNet, when you talk about SquizNet, these are all the hybrid algorithms. When you consider BGG-16, these are all the algorithms which is made. So we need a people, we need a group of community people like us. We can join one forum and we can develop group of algorithms which can be patented and which can be utilized by across the globe. So India needs this kind of a developers who can develop the algorithm for the welfare of the nation, not for the welfare of personal welfare. They need a people. We need a people to develop the algorithm. That's what. And my startup, we have like a company, like we are the division, we are developing lot of algorithms and just need to post it and we'll share it to everyone else. So just check it out on what has happened. So we need something else and somebody else to talk about it. And we need people who can join hands and to work for this. This is the second thing which is required. And third thing is about deployment, which is most important. Since now we are using a Google mechanism, we are using a Google Colab and we are just using a cloud from this thing. And we need a people who can develop their own company and own startup, which can able to provide you such a kind of an tools which can be utilized by our country, not only our country, but across the globe. So these three points are required, and this can be done by this kind of webinars and sharing of knowledge and forming of a groups, developing algorithms. If that can be happen, I'm sure that not only a China, even any country cannot combat with our mechanism. So like minds is joining hands, like joining hands with like-minded people and working together for the development of the nation. Even though the business is important, we must concentrate about the business as well as the welfare. If we can do that, if we can club that, definitely, like, we can come out with, and we can challenge anybody in this world.
Okay, sir. So there's a question that can artificial intelligence be used in genetic analysis of the
polymorphisms? Yeah, like that can be done with that, with the help of a genetic analysis of polymorphism. I shall give you the mechanism of genetic memory, right? So it is kind of a prediction, like what we have, like that I told you in the healthcare system, we used to develop only this three pulses method. So these three pulses method was developed before a 5,000 years old. It was mentioned in Upanishads actually. And it was like, we call like gurus and who developed all this sort of stuff actually. And it is in South India, we call this Siddhas who developed it actually. So they have categorized each and every diseases, and even the genetic memories and genetic algorithms, or genetic memory in this case, one such case is genetic memory, where the previous things are been stored in the genetic memory, and artificial intelligence is used to predict even the character what you want. So this has all been done, and it is something an advanced research. So when you considered about this genetic algorithm and genetic mechanism, I suggest you to read some of the books from Vedas and Upanishads, which will give you the clear picture. Even though we don't know about it, we are Indians, we don't know about our tradition. I must make you to learn these things. When you learn these things, like, you can have what a reinforcement. You have a very advanced reinforcement learning also.
Yes, sir. So there's a question so can you give some tips on how to learn and master Kaggle?
Like mastering Kaggle is nothing. It just participate in the competition, get your data and post it on the data. But the data are important. For example, in the COVID-19, like, a lot of data are there, like, but we never concentrate on the one particular data. For example, I tell you, like, even though there is a lot of relaxation in this mechanism actually, lockdown, but the thing is, still the people are gathering in each and everything. Right, so when you go for a shop or when you go for a restaurant, you can't find a social distancing among them. And my suggestion is, when you go for there, you can't see there is a COVID. You are seeing, okay, it's a normal situation, and everybody is asking the same way. Everybody is asking me whether it is COVID is over or not. Being an artificial intelligence company, can you predict and tell me? I told them, like, I can't predict it because the people are different actually. So the logic here is, prepare a unique data set which is required. The example what I told you is the product. I tell you, like, each and every camera is to be collected, and my system is to be trained with the social distancing and the face mask and everything. And each and every place is being getting the data, and it should able to identify and give it. So collect this kind of a data and post it on a Kaggle. And if the data sets are unique, you will get an opportunity to work it. And just post the idea and post the algorithm, and you will get it out. So start with. When I do it, when you want to start it, do it, right? When you don't want to start it, you'll keep on asking the question. So my request is, once you want to start anything, do it. Because I am a background of electronics. Now I'm working on artificial intelligence, cloud and everything, because it's our necessity to update in that market. So remember it, please do it. Please collect some unique data and just post it and start doing it. If anything you want me to make it out, just I've shared my mail ID. You can put it out, I can help you out.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Okay, so there's a last question from my side, and it's not related to artificial intelligence or something. But then, sir, as we all heard about your, like, inspiring story about and how you believe, like, upon some specific power or something. So I just wanted to ask that, if we will see the current situation and the generation, where we are just focusing upon computerized and internet things, I guess, rather than to be focused upon our maybe I'm not specifying upon any religion or something, but then our roots or something, right? So, sir, how do you think that, as you have also just suggested, to read those books that we can get the ideas from the books too. So, sir, how you wanted to how you think, and do you believe upon faith rather than in comparison to the hard work also? And what you really wanted to suggest us to be connected with our roots and those specific power, just to get the confidence upon ourselves. So, sir, if you wanted to give any tips or something to ask.
That's a quite interesting question, actually, right? Right. I'll put up on another shocking news for you. Actually, I belongs to Muslim, actually.
Sir, actually, when I was pronouncing your name and then you said about Lord Shiva, then there was something in my mind. That's why I wanted to ask. That's really interesting.
Right. So, what is the thing is, you have a hard work, right? This is the philosophy. There is a hard work. We should work hard and we should get it. But the thing is, our thought decides everything. The God resides on you, not on a temple, actually, right? So the God resides on you, even any God, right? So I believe on Lord Shiva, right? I can suggest you, I don't want to go into that religious conflict, actually. But still, right, the God lies on you. And when the God lies on you, actually, right, you have to believe that whatever we do are good things, it will replicate you. This is what you called as, we don't teach our children, actually. So we must be very good, right? We must be thinking a good thought and it will give you a good thing. That's the first thing. And second thing is reading Vedas, Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita, Quran or Bible, whatever the case. They suggest you how to live it. It has been created at one scenarios, and we should not confuse this is best or this is bad. It is created at one point of time, actually. And that is the logic which we have to come across here, that we have to understand. And the removal of a temple. Temple, we don't what we do in temple is we just go there, worship and come back. And temple is not, has been not been utilized. The temple is not a worship. It is nothing but it is a gathering of energy from the universe, right? It resembles our human body, actually. It resembles all the human body which is there. So when we go there, it is a clear, we have tested personally, it is a gathering of an energy from the universe and it circulates you. That's why Deepadhanais and all these things have been shown to grasp the energies, electromagnetic radiations. It has been made here, actually. So we must be very, very, very clear about it. When you go for the temple, it really, really, really makes your brain or makes your body good. So that is important. And this generation doesn't understand everything, right? So this has all been formulated and this has all been designed before 10,000 or 15,000 years ago. But this has not been properly followed. So it is an energy consumption. When you go for an Einstein's theory or anything, this energy conservation is followed, right? And this temple is a place of an energy where you can gather the positive energy and you can circulate to among yourself. So by reading the books, not only in what has been said, it has been said in all the books, it has been said, do good things, have a positive thing and share everything with you and gain knowledge. So this is what the thing. There is no happening of a heaven or a hell. There is no kind of a concept here, right? Whatever you do, you will be happy. Whatever you think you do, some ill effects, it will create on your will and make you unhappy. This is what the simple life's formula. When you develop this kind of a thing in your mindset and you work on that, you'll be taking out, actually, right? So I can share you with Lord Shiva's miracle everywhere, right? Because it will be a spiritual time.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
That is what is the logic, actually.
Thank you so much, sir. Your experience and words, everything was so your insight and perspective on the subject matter and also on life and everything was so so much. Literally, I can connect with it, and I really wanted to implement in my life too with the positive thoughts and good thoughts. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks for this great event on the behalf of my team. First and foremost, I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for Mr. Ankit Lekhra, Mr. Jekin Dedhia, and Mr. Akash Surega, and of course, for inviting us today. your views and thoughts. So I must thank also I must thank our attendees. I thank you all for your participation and making this event successful. So also I request you all to kindly join us tomorrow for evening session with speakers from the startup and entrepreneurship ecosystem related to women. So with this, we come to an end, and thank you so much for joining.
Thank you, and all the best for your future endeavors. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir.
Ma'am, are we getting e-certificates for the same? Hello.
Yes, yes, am I audible? So basically, yes, we are at, like, you all are attending every day, then we will provide the
okay, ma'am. I missed a session yesterday. I think
okay, so. There's no issues, please. No issues. Please continue with our, like, tomorrow sessions and further sessions.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, it will be given at the end of the event.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you,
ma'am.
Thank you.
Ma'am, I have a question. Can we send message to Ati sir on LinkedIn or email? Can I?
Yes, of course. Sir has shared this with you all, guys. So whatever you want to ask, I would suggest please connect like with sir on LinkedIn. That's a professional platform, and you can like reach out there, and you can ask your questions there. So I guess our session has come to an end, so you all guys can leave. And we are looking for tomorrow's session.
Thank you for joining. All of us can leave, and our organizing members can wait for a few minutes. Others can, you know. All are requested to leave the meeting. Agnes, Fatima, Anshu Rani, Atul Kumar, Gaurav Khaitan. Everyone is requested to leave the meeting. Nirbhay, Prathamesh, Shubham, Dohaiya, Kamlesh Bansal, Atul Kumar, Kamlesh Bansal. Prathamesh Upadhyay ji, we can leave. Kamlesh Bansal ji, aap leave kar sakte hain. Okay. अब सब अपने ही टीम मेंबर्स हैं, तो एक बार छोटा सा रिव्यू ये सेशन कैसा रहा, कोई भी स्टार्ट करके स्टार्ट करे. साहिल जी आप स्टार्ट कीजिए. ओके, शिवानी जी आप कुछ ऐड कीजिए इसमें.
मैं क्या ऐड करूँ पहले, लाइक ओवरऑल द सेशन एंड द स्पीकर्स वाज रियली गुड. स्पेशली आई रियली लाइक द लास्ट सेशन बिकॉज इट वाज अ बिट इंटरैक्टिव एंड लाइक नॉट स्पेसिफिकली कनेक्टेड टू लाइक दैट टिपिकल. काफी ज्यादा टिपिकल नहीं था, काफी थोड़ा.
जस्ट अ मिनट, सॉरी फॉर इंटरप्शन, जस्ट अ मिनट. आदित्य जी, दिस इज गोइंग लाइव सो वी कैन स्टॉप इट. वेल आई एम स्टॉपिंग. ओके, सो अभी तो एंड करते हैं, बाद में फिर डिस्कस कर लेते हैं, फिर ये लाइव जा रहा है. ओके, सो फाइन, वी कैन लीव.